12, will you stand and sing with us?
I'm alive because I'm alive in you. He is the light shining in the darkness. He is the hope of all the nations. And Father, as we stand here this morning just praising your name, Lord, I just ask that you would just help us to be that light to this world, Father. And as we celebrate with those that are being baptized this morning, that we could just be a community to encourage them and to walk through their journey with them. Lord God, that you would just ignite a fire in their hearts to reflect the light that you are to this world. We thank you, Father. In your name we pray. Amen.
I feel the nations of this earth are shaking. There's no power that can match his grace. Lift up your head, lift up your eyes to see. All of creation is waiting and longing. Sons and daughters do declare this truth. Lift up your head, lift up your voice and see. He is a light shining in the darkness. He is a hope, hope of all the nations. World to see. hope of all the nations. He is alive. He is alive for all the world to see.
He is alive.
He is alive, shining in the darkness. He is a hope, hope of all the nations. He is alive. He is alive for all the world to see.
Would you pray with me? Father, you are the creator of light, and light is good, and light gives us hope for something in the future. But we know that we live in a fallen world, often a dark world, God, and we need help finding our way back to you. And you say in the Bible that you are the light of the world, that if we would find you, if we would believe in you and receive you into our lives, that you have the power to flood our lives with a holy light, your Holy Spirit, a power that can help save our lives, change our lives, and give us the direction on a whole new journey. And today being Baptism Sunday, we have a whole group of people that are here today. What an exciting day it is, because they are saying to the world that we received you into our lives, and we want the whole world to know about that decision. And so, Father, we celebrate that, but we also know that there's people in here that may not have made that decision at this point. And so we pray that somebody's story that they hear along the way prompts something in them so that they would look to make that decision for you and go public that with that in their own lives as well. So bless this service today, God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, before you sit down, turn to somebody and ask them their name. Well done. All right. Good morning, everybody. Well, welcome. For those of you that haven't had a chance to meet, my name is Craig Stiven. I am a volunteer here at the Well, so I am one of you just utilizing this opportunity. One of the things I like to do on a Sunday morning, more than anything, I used to be a guy who woke up and golfed on Sunday. Now what I like to do is I like to come here and greet people. I'm part of the hospitality team, so this morning I'm your service host. Basically want to welcome you to this weekend's services. We are glad that you're here. We hope that the service is meaningful and makes an impact on your life. One of the things we want to do, I don't know if you saw them when you came in, but there's people who are wearing these blue name badges. See, they got people who are wearing them. And what they are is these are people who are serving on Sunday morning. They're serving in the body, just being available in different ways. And one of the ways that they can be utilized is you can go to them and ask any kind of questions or get directions around the building, anything. So we just want to recognize the service that they do, but also want to let you know that they can be a service to you if you want to reach out to them. So as we switch gears now, during our service, we are obviously going through a worship period, and one of the ways you can worship is through your giving, where you give financially back to God. You're giving back a portion of what he's blessed you with. And so if you came today prepared to do that, you could do it at any point throughout the service. You're simply just going to take it over to one of those boxes on the wall, you drop it in, and you're all good. Now, if you want to go online and set it up, just make it more consistent, you can do it at cometothewell.org/give, and you can set it up that way. They just walk you right through that process. But what we do is when you give, you're giving to what happens here on a Sunday or out throughout the week, but you're also helping different organizations that we partner with, and every week we highlight one of them, and this week we're highlighting the Lambert family. It's a new couple that they're living out their ministry in the historic country of Turkey. They've been doing it for just a little while, but the mission that they're a part of is they want to see worship established. They want to see leadership, people leading worship all throughout the country of Turkey. We want to raise those people up. So they lead them, they train them, they disciple them, and they basically start that in their church, and then the people go throughout the country and they do this training and worshiping and discipling. So one of the things they did is we asked them recently, could we be praying for anything? And they commented that they had a praise. They recently had a leadership training that they were excited about, and they just wanted to share that it went great. So they were a little nervous about it, but in the end, it went great. They felt the Spirit moved within the participants, and also that the Spirit moved within the teaching that they did. One other area that they wanted to sort of ask for our help in is they work with refugees. There's a church that they're a part of. There's a refugee camp nearby. And one of the things that they're saying is there's just not enough resource to help the people that they would like to have that. So they're asking, and they use the words, you know, the provisions of heaven to be opened up, and they're asking for our prayer. So would you bow with me as we pray for that organization and the gifts that are given? Father, we thank you for the people here at the Well who give so sacrificially to not only building your church here, in Geneva, Illinois, but building your church around the world. And so we thank you for the Lambert family who has taken a step to go to the other part of the world to spread your love. So we would ask that you would identify new groups of people that they could train, you would identify individuals that they could disciple, and that your love could be spread throughout that whole land. And so, God, we have refugees that people just so often forget, and we just want to pray that you could just shower that world with financial resources, with people to help, and you could just let people know, especially the refugees, that you are a God that loves and a God who doesn't forget. So we thank you, Father, and we ask that you bless them in Jesus' name. Amen.
My relationship with Jesus has changed my life, obviously for the better. And all my hardships and struggles, me believing in him and praying, he has gotten me through some very hard times. And it has also made me appreciate the blessings that I have received and the great things that he will do for me. I know I will appreciate them even more because I know that they will be gifts from him also. I have decided to become baptized here at the well this Sunday as a recommitment and a new beginning in my heart. I was baptized as a baby through my parents, and I have always been raised in a God-loving home, but with me getting married this year and then after that starting my own family, hopefully, I just want that recommitment and that love in my heart just to be full again, and I feel that the first step is being baptized here at the well this Sunday.
It's changed my faith and my happiness, because when I walk out of church, I'm just more happy.
Well, over the past year, probably it's really grown, because I went on mission trips. I went on the Denver mission trip and then the Guatemala mission trip just a couple weeks ago. And I think I've become more confident in my faith. My relationship with God has really changed my relationships with my family and my friends.
So I think my relationship with Jesus has not only just changed my life, it's completely like redefined everything I do. So I've always been Christian, and I went to a Catholic church and went to Catholic school, and I kind of just never was fully into. I was kind of just going through the motions and never really involved with my faith. And then in 2013, I was diagnosed with depression, and it was just a really hard time for me. And I was angry with God, and I was just asking him to take all these negative thoughts I had and just lift them off my shoulders, but it would never happen. And I still just felt terrible, and I stopped going to church. I kind of stopped having a faith, I think. And then in 2015, I met my boyfriend Josh, who's also getting baptized, and he was the answer to all my prayers pretty much, because he brought me to the well and he showed me the love of Jesus and how the only thing I needed to do during my hard times was let Jesus in, because he was there waiting for me, but I was the one with the closed doors. So pretty much, Jesus is my savior, and he saved me.
Good morning. How's everyone doing today? Good? Good. Thanks so much for coming. Welcome to Baptism Sunday. I'm so excited. Can we just give it up for all of our baptismal candidates? We're so proud and excited for them. This week, I had the opportunity to go to the annual ARC conference. We are a member of ARC, which is the Association of Related Churches, and we are a church planting organization. We've planted about 600 50 churches so far in our history, and this year, we decided to really try to do more than we've ever done before, and so at the conference, they announced that already this year, in the first 4 months of this year, we have started 59 churches here in the United States. Yes. Yeah. And in addition to that, we've actually also planted 13 churches just in China. So those are underground churches. So, and here's the reason I tell you that is because that's what you are doing Your participation here at the well, your generosity here at the well, is literally changing the face of our world, of our communities, of our culture, and you are a part of planting life-giving churches around the world. This year, we are planning, we are hoping and praying to still launch about another 95 churches, so we will launch over 150 churches in this calendar year. And just in the last 12 months, we've launched about 110, and in those 110, just in their first service, in each one of those churches' first services, we saw more than 600 people come to Christ. So God is doing some amazing things, and it's all credited to you and your engagement, your involvement, and we're building the kingdom. So let's just give God praise for all the things that he's doing in the well and through the well. I have four kids. I love my kids. They're great kids. You hear me tell stories about them all the time. Usually, they're at least in some part sort of in a negative way. So I just want to affirm that I love them. They are amazing. And they really reflect me. They reflect my value. They reflect my character. They reflect the things that I believe are important. And so my two oldest sons, Isaiah and Elijah, they are actually students at Moody. Isaiah will graduate in the fall with his bachelor's, and we're excited. And then he's looking at going on and pursuing his MDiv. And Elijah is about to finish up his second year of Bible college, first year at Moody. And they both want to go into vocational ministry. And then my oldest daughter, Taylor, is pursuing psychology. And then my youngest daughter, she wants to marry a rich cowboy. So maybe she more reflects Carrie. I don't know. But here's what I really want you to hear is that our family loves God, and our family loves people, and we live to serve God and to serve people. And so the core values that we have here at the well originally started off as Carrie and I's family core values. We sat and labored over those to try to figure out how we would take all the things that were most important to us, that we felt like were most important and foundational in our faith, and be able to articulate them in a way that our kids could incorporate into their lives. And I believe with all my heart, when I look at my kids now, that they are living embodiments, they are living reflections of those values that we hold dear as a family. And here's what I want you to understand. You are designed to reflect the nature, the values, the character of your father and your family as well. So hold on to that thought. Today we're actually finishing up our series, Fulfilled, where we've been sort of unwrapping this idea that the life, the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ was the fulfillment of everything that God had promised, everything that he had said, everything that he had foreshadowed, everything that he had planned. That the good news of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, that was the full image and representation of God, and it was the core values, it was the foundation of everything that we needed to build our lives on. That's what Paul is pushing into in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 8. This has been sort of our foundational passage as we've moved through this series. And Paul says, let me now remind you, dear brothers and sisters, of the good news. That's that word gospel. It's where we get the word gospel. The good news, the gospel that I preached to you before. You welcomed it then, and you still stand firm in it. It's this gospel, it's this good news that saves you. And I passed on to you what was most important and what was passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as the scriptures said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scriptures said. He was seen by Peter and then by the other 12, his closest friends. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers, those people who had known him and followed him in life, most of whom were still alive at the time of this writing, although some of them had died. And then he was seen by James, his brother, and later by the apostles. And this word here is being used of all of the church leadership. And last of all, as though I had been born just a step out of time, I also saw him. I love how Paul adds himself into this story, into this narrative. He's saying, I've seen him too. I knew him, although not in life, only in the resurrection. But in knowing him and seeing him and entering into this relationship with him, I've been changed. He has changed me. And here's what I want you to understand. Paul was saying, listen, those things that were foundational, this gospel, this good news is what has formed my life, and it has changed me to reflect it. That's what I stand on. That's what saved me. That's what I communicated to you. And in the same way, our lives, as we take the gospel, the good news, the life of Jesus into us, it's designed to transform us and reshape us into the very nature of our Heavenly Father, so that our lives reflect the nature, the character of God and His kingdom. In Colossians, Scripture says that everything there was to know about God was revealed in Jesus. Everything God wanted us to know, everything God needed us to know, everything God wanted us to embrace, everything God wanted us to experience, everything God wanted us to express and reflect in our own lives is resident in the historical person of Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah. And so our lives are to reflect the very nature, the very life of Jesus. Our lives are supposed to be living reenactments of the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's only as we have the kingdom formed in us, it's only as we have the King formed in us, it's only as we have Christ formed in us, that we're really able to experience the transcendent nature of His kingdom, the eternal qualities of Christ, those things that are larger in life, and all of the good and the wonderful things that God purposed and planned for you when He was knitting you together. And so our lives need to proclaim, they need to be proclamations of the God life. We communicate the God life through our own. And one of the best tools to do that really is baptism, what we are celebrating today. Baptism is a proclamation. It is a declaration of the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ that we are entering into just as we enter into the water. So when Peter was writing to the church in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21, he said, "This water is a picture of baptism which now saves you, not by removing dirt from your body." In other words, it's not the physical principles that are important, but as a response to God from a clean conscience. It becomes an outward expression of an inward work. It is effective because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Baptism is so much more than just a symbol, though. It is holy and mysterious, and it forms a union in our lives and in the expressions of our life with the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In fact, all of our faith, all of our worship is designed to do just that. Our worship, our evangelism, our social justice, even our suffering is all designed to have meaning, to have value, not in that it saves us by virtue of those acts or those behaviors, but those acts, those behaviors begin to demonstrate the nature, the character of God and His kingdom being formed in our lives. If God is being formed in us, then our lives, like our baptism, become the proclamation of our hope, of our confidence, of our faith that we place in Him. We are basically saying that we are not our own, that our lives are not our own, that we have laid ourselves aside and come up out of the water in new life. Now we are dead to ourselves, but we are alive to Jesus. So Jesus lives in me. Jesus lives through me. Jesus is being made flesh again in this vessel of flesh. Maybe the best way for us just to sort of unpack this idea is seeing it happen in the life of someone that we're all very familiar with. And so we're going to look at the transformation that happens in the life of Paul. one of the early church leaders. He wrote over half the New Testament, and he's given us most of what we understand in terms of written form about our faith. And so if you want, you can turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 9. If you're using an internet device, you can use our app as well as any other, but our app has not only all the scriptures provided for you as well as an outline, and we'll have some little fill-in-the-blanks that you can do with us. But here's what I want you to see. At the beginning of our story, Paul is really searching for meaning. He's searching for something that sort of transcends. He realizes that his life is designed with purpose, with eternal purpose, and he's trying to live up to something that is bigger, that is more important than himself. He is trying to do something outstanding for God. So in Acts 9, verse 1, it says, "Meanwhile, Saul..." Prior to his conversion, Paul is called Saul. Afterwards, to mark the change, he takes on the name Paul. Meanwhile, Saul, or Paul, was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. So he went to the high priest to request letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any follower of the way, which was the original name that was given to Christians. Any Christians that he found there, he wanted to bring them, both men and women. This guy was hardcore. He was serious. Back to Jerusalem in chains. So Paul is wanting, he is trying to do something for God. He wants to do something that is bigger than himself. And he's looking for meaning. He's looking to make a difference. And oftentimes when we go on that search, oftentimes we start with a question that sounds something like this: who am I? What is this life really all about? And I would submit that we start from a wrong place, and because we ask a wrong question, we never get ultimately to the answer that we're hoping for. Because if we're looking for transcendence, which by definition means something bigger than ourselves, by turning inward to try to discover who we are, then in the end, our search for self will only produce self. It doesn't actually produce transcendence. In order to find something in life that is truly meaningful and bigger than ourselves, we have to look outside of ourselves. And so perhaps a better question for us to ask is, who could I become? What could God do in me? What could God do through me? Because ultimately, Jesus is always the one who initiates. God is always the one who starts and is the impetus behind our story and our movement and our transformation. In verse 3, as Paul was approaching Damascus on the mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him, and he fell to the ground, and he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. And the voice replied, "I am Jesus. I am the one that you are persecuting." So it's interesting that Paul is on a mission trying to do something for God, but he isn't actually looking for him. He wants to do something for him, but he isn't trying to necessarily connect with him. And so Jesus reaches out. He arrests Paul's journey. He arrests everything that Paul is doing to get him engaged with him. And here's the beautiful thing that I want to encourage you. If you're sensing a desire in your heart to make a difference, to begin to do something that is larger than yourself, to look from the inside and begin focusing your attention out on the world around you, that spark, that drawing, that wooing, Scripture says, finds its origin in God. Anything that is good or noble or life-giving or lovely or beautiful, all of that begins with God drawing on our hearts. But once God begins to draw, we have to cooperate. We have to choose to respond. So Paul chooses to cooperate with what Jesus is up to. And in verse 6, it says, "Now get up." Jesus is speaking here to Paul. "Now get up and go into the city, and you'll be told what you must do." And the men with Saul stood speechless. They had heard a sound of someone's voice, but they saw no one. Saul picked himself up off the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus. He remained there blind 3 days, and he didn't eat or drink. It's interesting and a bit troubling that when Jesus enters our story, when Jesus enters the narrative, Paul's situation does not actually get better. When Jesus enters the story, Paul's circumstances, Paul's life actually gets harder. Jesus enters the story and begins to engage Paul, and immediately Paul starts losing things. The first thing that he's going to lose is he's going to lose his identity. Paul was a Pharisee. He was a leader in a religious sect in Judaism that had denounced Jesus as the Christ. If he were going to cooperate at any level with him, he would lose that identity. Paul was going to lose his purpose. He had set off on a mission to go to Damascus to shut down the church. He was pursuing an ambition, a desire that was in his heart. But if he was going to cooperate with Jesus, he would have to set his own ambition, his own desire, his own purpose and designs aside to connect with God's. He lost his dignity and his reputation. He leaves Jerusalem heading towards Damascus as a leader, but he has to be led into Damascus. Paul could have said, you just struck me with blindness. I'm not going to do anything you ask. But what Paul understood is that the only way his life was going to make a difference beyond the scope of the days that he had been given was if he could find a right way to connect with God. And so despite the cost, despite the fear, despite the personal injury, Paul pursues God. Choosing Jesus cost Paul everything, but he follows him to make a difference, to find transcendence. Paul isn't the only person in our story that chooses to cooperate with God. There's another man named Ananias. Ananias also chooses to cooperate with God. Let's look at verse 10. Now, there was a believer in Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord spoke to him in a vision, calling, Ananias. Yes, Lord, he replied. The Lord said, go over to Straight Street to the house of Judas, and when you get there, ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He's praying to me right now, and I've shown him in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and laying hands on him so he can see again. Now, I just want to kind of pause in our story there and just sort of reflect on what's going on. Could you imagine if you were sort of in your house, in your inner place, and you were praying, and all of a sudden you sort of felt this prompting in your heart or in your mind of God saying, hey, listen, what I want you to do is I want you to go down to Geneva, and I want you to go onto Second Street, and I want you to go into that little restaurant there called Niche, and I want you to talk to the bartender. His name is David, and he's expecting you, and just go up and start praying for him. Yeah, it's a good plan. Or even worse, could you imagine if you were walking down the street and saw someone who was blind or deaf or paralyzed, and God said, go put your hand on him, tell him that I'm going to heal him, and then I want you to pray for him, and they're going to be healed. Can you imagine the anxiety that Ananias felt? But that didn't even begin to touch what he was feeling. Watch this. But Lord, exclaimed Ananias, I've heard many people talk about the terrible things this man has done to the believers in Jerusalem. What he's referring to is in Acts, at the very first martyrdom, the martyrdom of Stephen, Paul was present, lending his credentials, lending his authority, lending credibility to what they were doing. Luke talks about it in Acts chapter 7, but Paul talks about it himself in Acts 22, and you could tell it was something that had left a deep inner scar, that he had been a part of that. And now, that had kind of been because a mob just kind of came up, and it was mob mentality, and it just sort of took over, and Paul hadn't been involved personally, he had just been there lending credibility to it, but now Paul has authority. Verse 14, now he's authorized by the leading priest to arrest everyone who calls on your name. If I show up and say, Jesus told me to come pray for you, that's enough grounds for him to arrest me and have me at the very least thrown in prison indefinitely and perhaps killed. But the Lord said, go. Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to the Gentiles and to kings as well as the people of Israel. And I'll show him how he must suffer for my name's sake. When Jesus enters your story, it's always going to cost you something. Perhaps there's a relationship in your life that needs to change some. Perhaps there's an identity that you have, the way you see yourself, that needs to be set aside. Perhaps there's a pursuit or an ambition or a drive or a purpose that you have given to yourself. And God is saying, would you put that aside to pursue the purpose that I have for you? Maybe it's setting aside our reputation or our dignity even. Being willing to be a fool, if you will, for Christ. But think for just a moment what it cost Christ to reflect, to demonstrate the love of God the Father to us. And so in verse 17, Ananias went and he found Saul and he laid his hand on him and he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road has sent me so that you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. I love it. And he just like, he just kicks open the door, puts his hand on him, calls his shot. He's like, Jesus, the one you met on the road, man, I hope that's true. The one you met on the road sent me here to pray for you and be healed. You do need healing, right? Please need healing. He just goes in, he puts his hand on Saul, and he just, man, he just speaks at the place of his highest hope. He just lives what he is convinced in his heart. And immediately, instantly, Scripture says, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he regained his sight. And then he got up, and he was baptized to express, to reflect with his life the thing that was happening in his heart, to become a reflection, to become a demonstration outwardly of what God was doing inwardly. Afterwards, he finally ate some food, and he was strengthened. If you want to find transcendence, if you want to make a difference, if you want your life's eternal qualities to produce an eternal harvest, it's going to come because we are willing not to take the reins of our life, but to release the reins of our life. Whatever personal cost that might be, to become living demonstrations, living embodiments, living reenactments of the gospel, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because Paul understood that God wasn't going to be able to do something through him until he had done something in him. That God can't build his kingdom or his character into the world until he has first established his kingdom and his character in our hearts. Paul finally finds real meaning. Verse 19, Paul stays with the believers there in Damascus for a few days, and immediately he began preaching about Jesus in the synagogues, saying, he is indeed the Son of God, the one I came to denounce and deny, now I am proclaiming. And all who heard him were amazed. Isn't this the same guy who caused such devastation among Jesus' followers in Jerusalem? And didn't he come here to arrest and take them in chains to the high priest? Didn't this guy come to destroy them and now he's building them up? Didn't he come to fight them and now he's defending them? And the more he did, the more he set his own life aside and pursued the God life. Saul's preaching became more and more powerful. The Jews in Damascus, they couldn't refute his proofs that Jesus was indeed the Messiah. And in the end, what Paul understood is that meaning, transcendence, making a difference, that's actually better than life. Verse 23, he said, after a while, some of the Jews plotted together to kill Paul. They were watching for him day and night at the city gates so that they could murder him. But Saul was told about their plot, so during the night, some of the other believers lowered him in a large basket through an opening in the city wall. The man that God had set to destroy, he ultimately gave up his life for. The people that he had sent to enslave, God used him to set them free. The mission that Paul believed was worth taking lives for, in the end, he gave his life for. Making a difference, meaning, purpose, transcendence is better than life. So how do we engage? How do we connect with the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, in a way that our life reflects the nature of his kingdom? That in the same way that baptism is a reflection, it is a living out of our hope, how do our lives become living testaments of the hope that we hold in our heart? The first thing is we need to get a specific vision of what is next for our lives. Here's the thing. My kids, any one of them, could have or still might in the future reject our family identity. They could decide that it's more important for them to be independent on their own, to discover who they are for themselves, and push away our family name and our family set of core values and behaviors. But what my kids have learned and are learning is that in doing that, all you feel is isolated and smaller and alone. But somehow, when you give yourself something, when you give yourself to other people, when you give yourself to God, that in the midst of sort of giving yourself away is when you really find yourself. It's when you discover that in the midst of those values, it's in the midst of that kingdom, it's in the midst of being fully formed for what you were designed to do, that you discover those unique qualities that God has in the midst of that story, in the midst of that picture, in the midst of that living reenactment of his love, not just for you, but so that through you, he can express that love to the world. So maybe your step this morning is that you've never had that road to Damascus experience for yourself. You have never had an encounter with Jesus Christ. You can. All you have to do is accept that Jesus was the Son of God, that he came and lived for you, that he died for you, that God raised him from the dead. And not just to give it mental assent, but to embrace him as the creator and the Lord of all things and invite him into your heart. Maybe you've done that, but you've never expressed that inward hope in an outward way. So your next step is baptism. I want you to know, if you're here today and you want to be baptized, you can. You can slip out into that hallway and right up here and into this room. We have everything that you need. We have shirts. We have towels. We had a couple people in first service. They were like, I'm coming back in second service. You don't have to leave and come back. You get baptized right now. Maybe your next step is beginning to allow some of those things in your life to be set aside. Identity, reputation, your own drive and ambition, so that Christ's life can be fully formed in you. Whatever that next step is, here's what I want to challenge you to do. This is number two. Be relentless in your pursuit of meaning. Be relentless in your pursuit of purpose. Your birthright is eternal. You were made to make a difference. Live up to the heights of heaven to which you were born. Pray with me. Father, we just thank you so much for the gift of your life, that we can take it in, that we could be reshaped and remade to reflect the glory, the nature, the good news of God, that our life could follow the rhythms of Christ's life, his death and his resurrection in such a way that it wouldn't just be life-giving to us, but that it would be life-giving to the world around us, that our life could be more than a sum of our days, that we can find transcendence, that we could find meaning, that we could make a difference. And everyone said amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God, only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified,
was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended into hell,
and he descended into hell.
On the third day,
he rose again.
On the third day, he rose again.
He ascended into heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father.
And he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I
believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Christian Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Life everlasting.
Life everlasting.
Amen.
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 And in your holy church, I believe in the rest.
Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. Silence the boast of sin and grave. Heavens are roaring. Praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above.
We may stand and sing this with me. What a powerful name.
What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Lift him up.
You know, the good news really is this, that God will never ask anything of you that he isn't trying to give something back to you that is so much better and so much deeper and so much more eternal than anything he would ever ask you to set aside. God has a good future for you, an eternal future, that your life would have purpose and meaning, that every one of your moments, although they might be difficult, would add up to something that is infinite in its scope. Would you pray with me? God, we just dedicate ourselves to you. Lord, we dedicate our lives to you. We dedicate our families to you. And we invite you to have your way. If that means you're going to mess with our identity, then we invite you to mess with our identity. If that means you're going to mess with our purposes, with our plans, with our ambition, then Lord, mess with our purposes and our plans and our ambition. God, if it means that we have to become of no reputation so that the life, the reputation of Christ might be reflected through us perfectly, then, Lord, we set ourselves aside so that you can live through us, that our lives would become embodiments, reenactments of the good news, the gospel, the life, the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And everyone said amen. 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 Well, if you have WAVE age kids, so if you have primary age school kids, any of these up here in the front, we want to let you know they are not going back to WAVE Cave. You're actually going to be checking them back out right out of the prayer room. So you can come right up here and through that door on my left and you can get your kids. We're just going to hold them there. It's a little bit easier for you and them. And so they'll be right in there. All of the other kids are still going to be over on the other side. I'm not sure if it's still raining. If it is still raining outside, we have some bins of umbrellas out in the foyer. You are welcome to actually take those with you out to your car. And then we ask you just to close it and set it down. Try to keep it as close to the yellow line as you can. And our parking lot team will come out and get them. So you can take them out, use them, just leave them on the parking lot. So we'll take care of you. keep you dry and do that. If you want, if you're a guest today, we would love to have the opportunity to meet you. If you want to do that, at the very top of the stairs on the right, that very first office is my office. It says lead pastor on it. You can go in there. We actually have a reception for you today just to say thanks for coming. Give us a chance to put a face to the name and say hi. If you don't have time because you're celebrating family, we totally understand. If you would like to connect with us, if you'll fill out one of our Connect cards and drop it in one of the boxes on your way out of the auditorium, we'll send you an email this week. Thank you for coming. Let you know some of the ministries that we offer and open a dialogue so you can let us know how we can minister to you most effectively. And of course, if you have a prayer need, you know you can fill those out, put them in the boxes, and we will be praying for you all week long. Before we head in our different directions, would you just raise your hands and receive a blessing? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. And may you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you were born to reflect, to show forth the glory, the praises of God, to reflect the very nature of heaven, to reflect your Father in heaven. And everyone said amen. Thanks so much for coming. We'll see you next week. Don't forget to invite a friend.